apparatus that was sitting there and not serviced, apparatus that was sitting there and not functional. Firefighter training was a big issue. Firefighter morale was low. There was no public education. There was no succession planning. The budget was okay, you know, like, but you guys have been really good with our budget. It's a significant increase, which has allowed us to attract more people. And we have a problem. We have a waiting list. We actually have a waiting list.
Wow.
But we don't have gear to put people in. So the strategic plan for that is we should be getting three sets of gear that we ordered this year any week now. And we'll hire three more. And we'll put them into the used bunker gear because none of them are certified firefighters yet, so they have to be fully trained. But they'll still be part of the team. They'll respond to calls, and they'll be our field support, so to speak. But oh, by the way, Jason Lamb. Do you all know Jason, my deputy? Sorry.
Yeah.
Sorry, Jason.
I knew everybody, so
I talk too much. So that's the big problem. And I think I told you that I was a little bit frustrated that we weren't getting enough people, locals, stepping up to the fire hall and knocking on the door. So we started to step outside the box a little bit, and we hired a couple of Lac-de-Bonny firefighters that live on Brookfield Road. So they're not, they're certified, or they're Manitoba Basic. There's three ratings of fire. Your Manitoba Basic, your Manitoba Certification, and then your NFPA Certification. Well, these folks are the Manitoba Certified already, so they know how to do bunker gear, they know how to respond to calls, they know the safety, they know the fire extinguisher thing, and they know how to put their PPE, their personal protective equipment on. So we hired them. What they do is respond directly to the call, and they basically arrive at the same time we do, so it's extra people on scene, because Part 42 of the Workplace Health and Safety Regulation doesn't allow us to enter a burning building unless we have sufficient people on scene to rescue the firefighters that are going inside. So basically it's called a two-in-two-out rule. We always send two firefighters into a burning building, and when we do that, we have to have two people standing outside. There are some exceptions to that. If you have an imminent rescue where there's a survivable person stuck in the house, we don't wait. It's all hands on deck, and you go hard, and hopefully you make the rescue. We hope that never happens, but those are the exceptions. And also if the fire is at the stage where it's maybe contained to one room or the box, and we can do a knock down from outside and go in, there's another exception to that rule. But generally, you want to be careful with that two-in, two-out rule. So the wage increase helped with the recruitment intention. The uniforms and building an identity, people are actually talking about the fire department. People want to buy our baseball hats and stuff like that, right? So we've got the attention of the community. Most importantly, we've got the attention of the firefighters. They're going, hey, it's pretty cool. You saw those guys in the parade, mm-hmm. right? That was their first day wearing their uniform. And they're pretty proud about that, right? And then I think we're offering pretty decent training. I mean, our attendance to training post or pre our running of the fire department was about 30%. Now it's about 95%. So it's really impacted our budget. And we train every week, 3 hours. Last year, like I said in the report, we want to offer valuable training. Like, these guys already know the basics. They know how to put up ladders, they know how to use equipment, they know how to do this. So we want to give them that advanced fire training that when they get on the fire ground, they're confident and they can deal with fully involved structure fire, or they can get in and knock down the fire, right? And it's practice. We're getting there, but we're not quite where we want to be. But I think after this winter, we will be. We're going to do lots of scenarios, get the officers involved in running the show. You know, like, my role as the fire chief is to stand back, watch, and smile, and watch these guys do good work, right? So that's basically what my vision is as a fire service leader, is give these guys the tools and the knowledge to do their work and let them have at it. So our goal is still to get 20 people. We've got a list of five that are that haven't made a formal application, but they're starting to You know, we've got a gentleman coming for an interview on the 5th, and we have another gentleman coming for an interview on the 12th. And what we like to do is bring them into the fire station at a drill, introduce them to the people, and spend a night with us and see what you think, right? Because we had one kid come, and I thought he was all gung-ho. I haven't heard a word from him after. Because this is serious business, right? We don't just go there and not do anything anymore. We work hard. These guys are sweating when we're done. So the recruitment and retention is going okay. The morale, I think it speaks for itself. You'd probably have to ask the firefighters for it, right? And from what I hear, they're pretty happy. They not too many complaints, I don't think. The training, like I said, we logged 733 hours of training last year. So on an average of $20 an hour, that's about $14,000. So our budget is, we've got between responses and maintenance and all that other stuff, we've got about $7,000 left. So if we keep going the way we are till the end of the year, we'll probably be $8,000 over budget, and that's where I need direction from you. Do you want us to continue on with weekly training, or what should we do? I think at the end of the day, when it's all said and done, and if people pay their bills to us, we should almost break even or just be slightly over our operating budget. So, but it's, we don't know what's coming our way. We don't know what, in terms of responses. I walked into fire hall last night to fill up bottles. I turned the machine on and I heard, what's that hissing? And now we have a pinhole leak in our air filter cylinder. So how much is that gonna cost? It's the unexpected, but we can't be without a filling station because then our training goes down the toilet. So it's the unexpected. We did respond to a call on Thursday or Friday, deer strike. So, I mean, we're going to put in the MPI claim, but again, MPI has messed up on their form. We're not on it again, so you type to them, and you have to wait for weeks to get a response for email. But that's $1,018 to go to a 20-minute call. You know, it's the way you word it. So we'll get money. But what I'm concerned about is that we're doing all these lift assists for the EMS. There's a couple of issues. Paramedics are calling for lift assist at the fire department to non-residents who show up at, when a paramedic unit brings a non-resident from another area of this country or this whatever, to the hospital. So as an example, a few weeks ago, pager goes off, they want 4 to 6 firefighters to assist with a lift of a 500-pound patient out of the ambulance. He's coming from Bird River. So we respond. Okay, because what I'm doing is I'm invoicing Shared Health for that response. Another example is Lactobonnie's getting fed up with going to lift assist, so they don't go. So with mutual aid, if they don't answer their page after 4 minutes, guess who gets paged out? Pinawa. So we go to the fire hall, we go, it's the middle of the night, and miraculously, the patient decides that they can get up and walk. So we're stood down, but it still cost me 3 hours times whatever number of firefighters showed up, right? So I billed, I think, probably 4 or 5, and none of them have been paid yet. We sent out invoices again saying you're overdue, and I think this is probably, they're probably not going to pay. So what I want to do is I think we'll take it up to the Manitoba Association of Fire Chiefs, and I think it's probably something that we should take it up with the MMA as well.
So who are you sending bills to? Shared Health?
Shared Health, the ERS, the Emergency Response Service.
There's an MOU, or like this is part of a policy that they're aware they would be paying this?
They're calling for our service.
Oh.
Yeah. We have our policy, our standard operating procedures, that we will respond to any ratepayer. We're not denying that. If the EMS calls and we need a fire department at 100 boroughs to help with CPR, we're responding right away, right? Or, I've used our guys lots for femur fracture, getting somebody at a house and stuff like that. But they're residents, they pay their taxes, they deserve the service, right? But when a guy showed up, he rolled his side-by-side 7 times in Lee River, he jumps in his van, drives to Pinawa Hospital, and he can't get out of the van, So they called the fire department for extrication. Without even an ambulance being there. They called the fire department for a left assist for a non-resident when there's another ambulance sitting there on a call where they could have just maybe telephoned them and radioed them. It's just the dispatch center, because I work with paramedics, is there's no consideration for municipal budgets. There's no consideration for our time. Like, why are you paging us out in the middle of the night? And all of a sudden your patient is able to get up and walk, so.
How much outstanding is those four invoices approximately?
Three grand. So, you know, like.
So I think we're at our next community health committee meeting, we're planning to have shared health there.
Yeah.
So I've made a note here to raise this issue. And, you know, this is a common issue. This is not just Pinawa there. And it's been ongoing for decades.
Yeah, but, you know, I mean, as an example, I was on a call as an EMS provider in Selkirk a few weeks ago. And I specifically asked the dispatch center, I need a second EMS unit here and I need an advanced care paramedic. Nope, we'll send the fire department. I didn't ask for the fire department. I asked for an ALS provider, you know, and it's they need to put a procedure in there that a supervisor at that region is contacted before there's any notification to fire service. Like, fire departments are really getting peed off. Like,
I've heard So it's was at our June district meeting at the AMM, and so this is being run up the ladder,
like,
municipally
they,
as too.
I mean, they haven't filled positions for years and years and years, and now they have no ambulances to send to help another crew. So it's the it falls on the municipality. So my direction to our officers is, we're not going to go anymore. That's what our procedure is if it's
a resident.
If it's not a resident, we're just not going until it's our pay. Like, we have no problem going.
Mm-hmm.
And they did the same thing in Winnipeg. They were calling Winnipeg Fire to go as help offload patients at HSC and Health Science Center, or at St. Boniface and Grace. And Winnipeg was becoming overwhelmed, and they said, no, we're not going. You call another paramedic. So they'll send a paramedic unit from wherever out of the region. I think for, in terms of how we're generating income, that's probably it. We did do a fire in Otter Falls. We're still working with the province and trying to get this initiative that there's money to be made if we can provide fire protection to the North Whiteshell. They're really dragging their toes on this, and I'm not sure why, but they're phoning us. Can you come and help us? They phoned us for a drowning and said, no, we have no water rescue.
Mm-hmm.
We're not coming. And they phoned us for a structure fire in Otter Falls. And they said, we'll pay, whatever it costs, we'll pay. We'll be right there.
And did you get paid for that one?
Yeah, but we got paid. What I did was I billed the insured first, and said, present this to your insurance company, and whatever, if they don't cover the whole cost, tell me and I'll bill it back to the parks. So, I mean, we're making a little bit of money. It's not a whole lot, but it covers.
It's covering the cost.
It covers, yeah. You know, like, we made $4,000 on the structure fire, and we were gone for a couple hours.
Mm-hmm.
It didn't cost us $4,000, that's for sure. So it was okay. So the training, we had an issue about pump operators and air brake. People couldn't drive fire truck. That issue's been solved. Most of our guys have air brake endorsement now. We didn't do an official certified pump ops course, but we spent a Saturday back in May. No, June 13th, and we did... We did pump ops all day, drafting, all kinds of things. And all the eight guys that were there, I'm pretty confident they can run a fire truck if we have a house fire anytime. So that's resolved. I think moving forward with the mutual aid district, when we start to come up with our training plan for this year, that's one of the things I'd like to see, is an official pump op course that perhaps we could host and get our guys certified, and then they can just do what's called relay pumping and stuff like that, because we don't have the capability to do that because we don't have a second fire truck. We have two people that are ready to go to their level one, which will start in September. I'm hoping that they're going on a regular drill night, so it's not an extra cost to us, and that's how we're trying to schedule that.
Mm-hmm.
So instead of coming to our practice, they'll just go to Dr. Bond and participate in the level one, the certification with Bird River, Lac de Bonnet, Pinawa, and White Mouth, and Pine Falls. It's time to get these guys a little bit more involved, my officers, and that's what we're trying to do. Is there's online courses that I've asked them to enroll in, and that's a role company officer. The incident safety officer isn't available yet, but fire service instructor as well. So these are courses that you basically do on your own time, and then when they go challenge their practical exams, wherever it is in Winnipeg or Brandon, that's when it would be some money out of our pocket, but that's not going to happen.
The registration of the courses are free?
Yeah, it's all free to, it's all through the Emergency Services College, and it's all free to municipal fire departments. I would like these guys trained up to a fire officer one, but they don't meet the prerequisites because they're not trained to level two fire. So we'll deal with that in the future. Public education is kind of taking shape. We had a really good week at the elementary school in June towards the end of the year. We got all the kids through there, and there were specific messages targeted to these kids. From K to 2 was matches and lighters are not toys. This is what they do. And if you find them, this is what you do with them. And it was fun. It was so much fun with the kids. Sparky came. Hub and Red River had all kinds of plush toys for us. We handed out to the kids when they were done. It was a blast.
Nice.
And then the older kids, we took them to the fire safety house, and it was all about, people don't realize that kids don't wake up when a smoke alarm sounds. They just don't. They're good sleepers. They don't know what the noise is. If they do wake up, they put their head underneath the covers and they go back to sleep. And I'm telling you, from experience, that's where we find children. Mm-hmm. They die right where they were when that smoke alarm was going off, because nobody teaches them. So what we did was, this is what a smoke alarm sounds like. This is what you do. And you get out, right? That's the only thing that's important. And go home and tell your mom and dad that. Mom, Dad, what do I do if the smoke alarm goes off today, right? And they were fantastic because we filled the whole half the smokehouse with theatrical smoke. We teach them how to sleep with their doors closed because it's an extra layer of protection when there's a fire in your home. And kids are so smart. You just have to show them the way, and they're like robots, right? Like, we could go pull the fire alarm in the elementary school right now if the kids were there. And they would line up, and all 300 of those kids would be out of that school in less than 2 minutes. Do it at home? Ah! That was that noise. What are you cooking now, right?
Yeah.
So,
what's cooking again?
So, I mean, if I ever get, or if we ever get into the daycare program and mom and thing, you know, mom and, you know, like little mom and pop groups or whatever, yeah. It's I've got so many good videos on experiments where I'm not just talking the talk here. I show them, you know, and they actually watch kids, if that was a real fire, die in a fire. And then they teach them what to do, and then months later, the testers come back and fire off the smoke alarm, and they have smoke throughout the house, and the kids just get out real quick. What else do we want to talk about? Any questions? Am I talking too much? I've been talking too much. I always talk too much.
You're doing good. We'll interject questions when they come up.
Okay. Principal Smith was really good. He was a bit sketchy when I first introduced this months ago. Well, is it going to scare the kids? Is it going to do that? Like, he's got legitimate concerns, right? And he was fantastic. He really embraced the whole project, and it went well. I think the teachers were happy. We had a kid. This teacher came up to me. He was in grade 6. I said, anybody want to put on the fire stuff? This kid jumped right up. I do. He's my size, right? He put on all the gear. I taught him how to use the face piece and the breathing apparatus. He's walking down. He's walking, high-fiving all his classmates, wearing all this stuff. And then his teacher pulls me to the side when it was all said and done. And she said, you just made a career path. You made his day. And he's she said, I guarantee you he'll be a firefighter. Like, good?
Yeah.
Excellent. Training, I have a bunch of fire extinguishers that we got to use up. 400 of them, in fact.
Wow.
Yeah. Generally nowadays, we do a simulator, but if what I'm going to use this for is we've distributed or we're starting to distribute at least half to throughout the mutual aid district to train the firefighters on fire extinguishers and stuff like that. There's a combination of the dry chemical and the CO2. We're going to use it for our needs at the fire hall, but I would also like to get the municipal staff trained on it, right? So my idea is to bring the municipal staff into the fire hall, and not just fire extinguisher, but just show them a little quick video on the value of sleeping with your door closed, and seeing how fire works and how fast and how evil and how dangerous it is, and then light up a pan of oil and or diesel fuel and gasoline and put out a fire, because the last thing you should be doing with this fire is reading the instructions on a fire extinguisher, right? Just throw the extinguisher at the. So we'll. I'll work with you and the public works people and whoever else. I'm going to ask Jen at the daycare if she wants her staff done, because we've got, I mean, what are we going to do with 400 fire extinguishers? Mm-hmm. So that'll be done on Fridays, because I went and got myself a full job.
Yeah.
Fire and safety inspections, we're at par with the regulation. Most of you know that we did a lot of work with the Pinawa Club this year. They were really good to work with. But it's housekeeping. You know, it's just, they have no place to put anything. They're so busy that all the cardboard boxes and everything get piled up underneath the stairs. And it's like combustibles if that ever catches fire. We're hooped, right? It's an older building. But
we discussed it at the club meeting last night, so yeah, we're on it.
And you know what? And we implemented a new procedure is that what they were doing when the fire alarm went off is that the alarm company was just calling the key holder and they'd investigate themselves. I went, no. The whole purpose of a fire alarm is to have your fire department show up at the same time you are, right? And how many weeks ago? 2:00 in the morning, fire alarm at the Pinawa Club. That doesn't sound right. We never go there. And sure enough, we get there. We had smoke. The building was full of smoke. So right away, I called mutual aid because, like, we need, if there's a fire in that basement there, we need manpower, right? And the boys got their BAs on, away they went, and they found the fire right away.
It was the key holders had their phones off.
Well, the key holder showed up with Dennis.
Eventually.
Yeah,
Dennis was there when we got there.
Yeah, so.
He's a little farther down.
Oh, he's a little
farther. Oh, is he?
Yeah, okay, so, but, you know, like, you need to call the fire department. That's your first call to alarm companies to the fire department, and that's why you pay your monitoring fee, and that's why you get a little bit of a decrease in the insurance rates, because you have a monitored fire alarm system. Apparatus, we're making really good headway on that. Thank you so much for okaying the deck gun, because I'll tell you, I've never seen so many happy firefighters in their life spraying that deck gun. So, the deck gun's been installed. Engine 1, our main pumper, has been pump tested. It's certified. It's got all the equipment on it to meet certification. I've done a little bit of research through NFPA about the automotive fire apparatus. And if we start to do stress tests starting this year, plus our pump tests and stuff like that, we can apply for an extension, a 5-year extension, so we don't have to go put out $700,000 in 11 years or whatever. But that's a work in progress right now. The problem with that, and what bothers me the most, is, I've said this before, like, I lose sleep over this stuff, but when the fire truck is out of the community and we have no apparatus and we're relying on locked body, I go, oh, I hope nothing happens today, right? So there's things happening that hopefully we're going to have some good news coming in September, October. We got our CAFS unit is up and running. We're going to train on that on our first drill on September the 5th. It was $8,000 well spent. The rescue, we had an assessment done on it. It will not pass the safety because it's got what's considered a level 2 oil leak. So it pools and it just creates all kinds of hazards on the roads and stuff like that. So what we did is we just put it to the side for now, because there's equipment that may be coming available from CNL, and there's things that we're still working on that mutual aid, or the revising the mutual aid agreement with them, or the automatic aid. So we're going to see how that goes, but I think it's going to evolve fairly quickly starting in September. So we'll know if we have to put money into this rescue or not. Because right now all we're using, we don't carry all our extrication equipment. It's sitting in the fire hall because we don't have room. We put it on the half-ton truck and we just take the basics. A little bit of blocking, recip saw, generator, and the jaws. So so it's a good thing we don't have a major highway here, but I'm surprised there's not more crashes for the float trail. There's lots of traffic, but the Mounties are doing a good job. What else? Eddie, Jason, jump right in there. So we talked about budget. So we've spent $96,000 of the $138,500 that we have. Our challenge is to stay within budget or close to it. For sure, without question, we won't be able to stay within budget if we keep trading the way we are. So that's where I need direction from you. Do you want us to go status quo or not?
We'll have to discuss that, Jeff.
I mean, everything else is just fixed cost, right? And then whatever surprises we get, like the compressor thing yesterday.
Mike, do you know how much you might go over if you continue with your training?
Well,
ballpark.
I figured for the turnout gear is, you know, I'm thinking we're going to be a couple thousand.
Okay.
But I don't know
right.
what, you know, like right now, what I did was I estimated the turnout gear, the three sets of turnout gear are going to come in at about maybe $7,000, but I estimated 10
right.
when I did my report. So there's a little bit of leeway there. And then we need to, we're going to schedule that level one training that is on our drill night, so it's not an extra cost to us. We're going to take on three more members. That's going to be an extra cost, right? So.
And training too.
Yeah.
Like if we're going to do the extra training with the officer.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, like all that stuff
yeah,
needs to come
yeah,
in
yeah,
too, right?
Yeah, well, you know, I didn't tell you, you guys are doing that for free. That's all online.
So is that 2024 though?
The cost for the officers will be
yeah.
2024 when they
yeah.
go. Like this is all online training, so it's basically you're doing it on your own
right.
time. And our guys last year, I think there was 11 that did the NFPA training, 1700. That was modern fire tech and all the building science and stuff with fire science and things like that. And nobody submitted any claim for that at all. Just because they're, you know, I mean, it's the extra training. So we'll see.
Yeah, so I have a couple of things if
yeah.
We're just about at the end of our time.
Yeah.
So, but I did want to raise an issue that Trudy and I met with Chuck Hanford and Murray Ellard from Awanipark,
yeah.
and they raised the issue about the challenge of getting affordable insurance with all the wildfires that are going
right.
on in the country if we don't get a tanker. So
so who's Murray?
Murray Ellard is another resident.
Okay.
And,
so, surprise, surprise, we got, I heard rumors that Pinawa was being downgraded, that the downgrade in terms of our fire protection. And that our insurance rates would be going up. That was a rumor going around town. So what I did last week was I contacted the underwriters and I said, hey, Mike Purtill from Pinawa, what's going on? Oh, it's just your scheduled, it's your regularly scheduled audit for you guys. So John, we're so glad you called because we have a lot of work for you now. So I don't see our there's a slight possibility that our rating will improve, but probably not. It'll probably stay status quo, so I don't think you'll see any increases in insurance rating. I think what Chuck talks about is that if we had a tanker and we used our mutual aid partners, is that we could challenge what's called a superior water shuttle operation. And basically what that is that you're shuttling water and you're filling up a static portable tank and you're flowing water uninterrupted at 200 gallons per minute. And if you can do that, you can bring that insurance rating down in the Awanipark area for people similar to Pinawa, because now they've classified as, well, you have a reliable water source, right? So there are things happening that a proper pumper tanker might be coming available.
Right.
That we need to talk about. And there's some contingency planning that we need to deal with at CNL, because they expect us to respond, but if our gear gets contaminated, it can't go off site, and now we don't have a fire department. So those are things that are happening right now. And I did read, it came across my desk at CNL today about, I mean, you all know that CNL has gone through, or is going through, a huge transition. They're separating the security from the fire. There's going to be 9 firefighters on shift 24/7. So that's going to allow them to allow 3 firefighters to leave and come and help us. So if we have a fire in Awanipark, they're there right away.
Right.
I mean, they're basically there in less than 5 minutes. So I don't know if I'm answering your question.
Well, like, I didn't expect an answer tonight anyway. Yeah. I'm just raising it because the issue was raised to me, and I checked today that we have $212,000 at the end of this year will be in the reserve, fire reserve.
Yeah.
And we started building up that reserve for the purpose of buying a tanker. So the ball's in your court to decide what your priorities are. I'm just sharing you with what was shared with me.
Yeah, well, the priority was to get the fire department up and running and the stuff that we have. And that came from reserve, which was... Well, that's the only money we had, right? Now we have to start thinking about, we need to replace our pumper eventually.
Yeah.
You know, because to meet that standard, the whatever it is.
Right. So I didn't mean this as a criticism.
No. I'm not taking it as a criticism at all. It's just I understand what they're saying, and a pumper tanker would be so valuable, but it just wasn't a priority for this year. And now moving forward, we need to look at how much we're going to put in capital reserve, how we're going to spend that money, you know.
Great.
It's
and there was just lots of news articles in the last 2 weeks about Canada overall insurance rates rising, especially in rural communities due to the forest fire. So that's sort of feeding some
of
this too.
Now, I'll just take 2 more minutes of your time, because I still believe that the biggest threat to this community is a wildfire.
For sure.
Okay, it's going to be a quick event. It's going to go through town, and... it's just going to be all those little spot fires that the fire department on our own won't be able to manage, because there's going to be too much going on, right? So it's all about public education. It's all about mitigation. But I can't get anybody to do the work. I've been after the province. I talked to Jeff Irwin yesterday, and I said, Jeff, what's happening with our assessment? It's not. So why not? We don't have any staff. Nobody can do it. They're tight. And I said, well, I can't get the monies from Fire Smart Canada or from anywhere else to start pruning and thinning and cleaning out the forest until I have a community plan. And you're part of that plan. You need to give me the risk assessment so we can see what we're up against, right? So you know what he said to me? You should talk to your council and see if you want to get, if they'll entertain a request for a quote from a private company. Because he said it would get there faster, but I'm going to stay on him, right? And that's a lot of the emails I get across my desk is, what are you going to do about? And you know, I mean, we'll talk about EMO later, but that's another issue,
right?
Is
so the second thing I wanted to raise is that we had a meeting with CNL last week,
right?
And it sounded very promising that they're going to provide us with some support to refurbish fire hydrants here in town.
Oh, good.
With parts and/or replacement,
See,
plus some manpower, plus some equipment, so that when you're doing flushing, you can actually measure flow rates.
Right.
Yeah. At the same time. So
Yeah.
So that was very good news. We thought you'd like to be aware of that.
And
so.
You know, I mean, We've been using the hydrant by the fire hall for our pump operator day, because you need to, right? And there's a real disconnect between the fire service and the public works people. Like, the public works people think that we need pressure. We don't need pressure. We need volume. Mm-hmm. Well, I don't care. Give me 5,000 gallons of water per minute at 20 PSI. That's good enough. I don't need, the fire truck's gonna create the pressure. Through, you know, so I'm working with Lacey a little bit, because this could be part of that the fire underwriter survey. It's all about your water distribution system, apparatus, manpower training, officer training, standard operating procedures, the whole works, so.
Excellent.
My work's cut out for me.
Okay, thanks, thanks for an awesome report and good discussion, and anybody else have any last minute questions or comments?
No, we just might need, maybe we should schedule a meeting and get through all the report, but yeah, maybe we'll have our own meeting and try to get through everything, and then I can bring it back to council exactly specifically what we want versus for the budget and stuff.
Yeah, okay.
So I'll connect with you on that. Okay?
Perfect.
And the EMO piece.
Yeah, I already touched base with him on that last week already.
All right, thank you, everybody.
Thanks.
You're gonna do the talking.
Meeting, governance committee of the council meeting to order at, 6:38 PM. We'll start with land acknowledgement. Anybody else like to volunteer to read it to me?
Thank you. Today we have the privilege to meet on ancestral lands of the Territory 1 and 3 peoples. We have gathered on the traditional territory of the Anishinaabe, Cree, Oji Cree, Dakota, and Dene peoples, and on the homeland of the Métis Nation. We respect the treaties that were made on these territories. We acknowledge the harms and mistakes of the past. We dedicate ourselves to move forward in partnership with Indigenous communities in a spirit of reconciliation and collaboration.
Thank you, Jason.
Yeah.
All right, so we have three additions to the agenda tonight, so we're looking for a motion to approve the agenda with the additions of 8.10, fires by pool on the beach, 8.11, Alexander Dock repair slash replacement, and 8.12, co-op propane pricing for 2023-2024. Is there a mover and seconder for that? Jason, Rhonda, any discussion? All in favor? That's carried. Okay, so we're at delegations. So, you guys have the floor, yes.
You want us to go to the front?
Sure.
Yes.
Sure.
That's
it? Okay.
So, I'm Kate Kaminski. I've been here a few times to see you guys. Jen Biskel and Bridget. And we're part of the Holiday Cheer Committee, so we're here with our first few items of the upcoming season. So I have some print-offs for you guys about what we're going to ask or talk about.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So as the 2023 holiday season approaches, the Holiday Cheer Committee have some requests for council. So below are the action items requested for approval and discussion. So the first is the Manitoba Hydro approval for adding electrical to more lampposts in town for the decorations. We did request approval through Hydro and they approved the request for 23 additional posts to have electrical added to them. So the next steps would be for the town to hire an electrician to do so. So we'd like to put that forward to you guys for consideration. And, you know, potentially that could be more than 1 year's worth. It's 23 that we had approved, but we can maybe do that over 2 or 3 years, depending on kind of what you guys are thinking. So last year, some of the old town lights were added to the light posts. We thought it would be a great addition to alternate wreaths and the old lights, but upgraded. So this would be pending the electrical being added to more light posts. So if the town likes this idea, we suggest to update the old lights by removing the old garland and upgrading the lights to rope lights, just so it looks a little bit more modern. And then the third request is we are also looking for an update on the storage shed for the holiday committee at the town yard. So we were told the shed was going to be for our use, and we believe the Lions Club as well. I think it was something we were going to share. So we want to ensure that the town will provide us with the storage space to continue to expand on the light display this year before we invest in more lights and decorations. Outdoor storage would also be sufficient for many of the light display items as well. So we're just kind of looking for an update on that. We hadn't heard anything since the end of last winter, so. Those are the three items we have for you right now. Were there any questions?
On number two, the new light purchases, is that your purchase? This is just information, or is that for the town to purchase the road lights?
We would like to request the town to purchase the lights, yeah. If you could consider that, that would be wonderful. And we can kind of allocate our resources to expanding the light display by the marina.
For the storage shed, so when was the last time you guys were out at the yard putting stuff?
I was out there in February.
Okay.
And, yeah, there.
Was there space yet?
They just had me put stuff outside, and then we had to come move it into that bigger shed after.
Okay.
The fact.
So I'm thinking things have changed since you guys were last on site. It sounds like you guys were using a C-can in a shed before.
Yes.
And that C-can's been removed from the shed, and it's the C-can that you guys and the Lions are sharing for space.
Yeah.
Which is a lot less than the big shed that you were in. So I'm just noting here your comment that some outdoor storage would be sufficient. So to be fair, I mean, this third request is probably going to go to Public Works anyways, and council wouldn't make that, like, it would be vetted at that committee level. But just wanted you guys to be aware that has since, the setup has since changed since new management came on, so.
Should we connect directly with the Public Works manager on that one?
I don't know how we were going to leave it.
It got kicked back this way from Public Works, so I think we should go with that one back with Public Works, and then we'll get back to you.
Okay.
Yeah.
Sounds good.
So we're going to have to contemplate we'll need some cost estimates, I think, to figure out before we can say what we're going to commit to. I don't recall at budget time that we specifically talked about including any of these kind of expenditures.
Right. So that is.
We've actually done work in kind before, more than actually paying for a contractor to come and do the work. So that's quite a bit of a different ask than we've had in the past.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And I guess that's something I would put to your committee, right? So we typically start budgeting in October for the next fiscal year, so our calendar year. So like Blair's alluding to, we didn't really budget specifically for Christmas committee items, but you know, depending where we get with these this year, but even if you have asks then that you know are part of 2024, depending where these get, these would obviously be in the 2024 ask for sure then, but if there's specific asks, keep in mind we always have to have them that October before for your, so 2023 was kind of last year.
So anything even for next season you want?
By October this year.
Okay.
Yeah. Just to help you with, like, your planning. I know that's difficult, right? But but that's just what we're faced with, right, for trying to plan expenses for the year.
That's good to know.
The items on this list, if they are not done this year, will it just, since we're here, will it automatically get kind of put for next year's budget, or do we have to come back with these items again?
I mean, we definitely could refer to budget if we can accommodate them this year.
Okay.
Yeah. But I mean, we'll obviously get back to you as well to let you know where things end up. But
absolutely.
Yeah.
Okay.
On number two, if you're replacing the lights, could I ask that some of them be colored? Because I prefer the colored lighting to the all white. That's my personal preference.
That's some feedback we've gotten, and I think that kind of played into our consideration of adding some of those more vintage looking lights back in with some color. So we have the alternating white lights of the wreaths and some color as well. So definitely.
and when we get to the storage space, I know when we talked about a Public Works, there's a question of, like, how much storage
do you need?
And is it going to grow every year? Like, storage space is going to be limited.
We have some stored here, actually, that we kind of drag in here every winter in the back. So maybe if we could even connect with the Public Works manager once you guys talk to them and see what space we're kind of working with, and then we can also take that into consideration with our planning of how we're expanding and how much storage we kind of have to work with. Because we do actually have quite a bit already.
Yeah, we do.
Lights and bins.
Yeah.
Okay, that's it for my questions. Any other questions?
No.
Okay.
All
thank
right.
you.
Thank you. And
thank
if you think
you.
Of any other questions, feel free to email pinnawallholidaycheer@gmail.com is our or an email address. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, so next item is easements for cemetery hydro and LGD land. So I read through these today. Want to speak to this, Judy?
Yes. So they're pretty straightforward. One concern I have is that Roger has included the LGD standards for design for construction of public works, and I don't know if any road that would be built on the LGD property to access the north end of the campground necessarily would have to be built to that standard. I would think it would just be...
It's just for internal use of the
yes,
campground, correct?
Yes, exactly. So just minimal standard for...
Whatever standard was used on their internal roads already,
exactly.
Right?
Exactly, yeah. Not full double wide road.
That would make
road.
Sense.
Yeah.
And, Okay, well, it seems like good advice to state it in those terms, right?
Mm-hmm.
The same standard as the roads in the, that already exist in the campground.
Exactly.
Right? We're all agree with that?
That's
yeah.
Fine, yeah. And, yes, and 3.03, there again, it quotes these LGD standards for design and construction, so that would have to be changed.
Okay.
And because these would be registered against the titles, Manitoba Hydro has either an easement or a caveat against it, so they would have to sign off. And then on the second easement, this is for the power line that runs through the campground. There would also have to be their financial institution and Manitoba Hydro signing off on it.
What number is that on there?
These are the attachments at the back after the LGD and
okay.
The campground signs off.
Yeah, I got it now.
It's not South Interlake Credit Union anymore.
No,
so that has to be fixed.
That would have to be updated. Or because the mortgage would probably still be, we'll figure that one out. And
it's access, actually. It's not
yes.
Even Sonoma, it's access now.
So those are the only issues that I had in reviewing it, plus one title. They had the wrong number, but, and this hasn't gone to the campground yet for their critique.
Okay. Well, we fix them up first and then
yes.
Pass them on.
Okay.
Any other comments from council?
Nope.
We've got a resolution on this already. This is just...
Yes,
you know, right.
This
okay,
is
perfect.
Review.
Okay.
Okay?
Yep.
Okay. All right, next item is a resolution on council members on committee, so I think we just defer this because the author is not with us, is on a leave of absence. Everybody okay with that?
Yes. Or should we just vote on it and then come back?
Pardon?
Or should we just be voting on it and...
Well, I think there's pieces that we agreed on and pieces that we didn't, and we kind of have to break down each one, I think, of like all those whereas statements. Some of them we discussed were already... we're doing in principle, but just putting them in, but some of them, like for the BCDC, we're not, so I don't know if we have to vote down the
voting tonight anyway,
no,
because it's just discussion, right?
Yeah.
Well, some of them affect our organizational bylaw,
right?
Too, so.
I think that's actually where all this stuff belongs, is in the organizational bylaw.
So I need to pass this and then change that, and it should
right.
Be all looked at together holistically.
Right.
Well, that 100% is the organizational bylaw
yeah.
that we should be bringing to this agenda
Correct.
And getting done. We're going to hit our 1 year mark of not having done it. And
yeah.
we'll be responsible to review it again.
We're going to need a special meeting probably just for
that.
For that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, landfill expansion options from engineer.
Okay, so John has met with Trevor Clausen from Higher Ground, and they have looked at all the calculations, and of course the roadway was not considered when they just took the top of the berm. They didn't consider
the
roadway.
They didn't know the road was in the middle, yeah.
Yes. So that changed the numbers significantly. But in talking with Giselle last night, she said that it was understood that the road would always be filled in as part of the landfill. I'm not quite sure on the logistics of that, but that was the intention to dump and push it.
And cover the road
yes.
on the final
so
layer, kind of,
build.
As you move out?
Yes.
Yep.
Oh, okay.
So, but based on...
I'll just comment. Option two, or option B,
option B,
was the option that we had assumed, or when we were first having these discussions,
mm-hmm.
was going to be the plan forward.
Yes. So 3-to-1 slopes maintained, moves top of berm toward the interior of the landfill. No new area to strip. Would need to build up the berm on the solid waste inside the landfill.
Right. That was the plan.
I will let John know that that is the consensus.
Well, I don't know. I'm just saying, I'm just sharing with the team
okay.
that weren't here that was the plan, is to build in.
Yes,
when we applied for the ISIP funding.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I think the idea was that as we, the same thing that happened the first time we expanded mm-hmm. was as we harvested the clay to build the berms, we ended up with a new cell ready to
right.
be utilized, but because there's lots of available footprint. The gate, the fencing is just a very small portion of the land. It's actually a very large footprint, but
uh-huh. And so even when we go with option B, or if that's what we're going with, we almost have to move into the next phase of the project because it only gives us another
year
maximum. So we have to start budgeting for a new cell.
What was the amount of the ISIP funding? What was the amount of the ISIP funding, do you remember?
I don't recall off the top of my head.
It was 75%. No, what was the percentage of funding? It's over $500,000, wasn't it? Unfortunately, we had started the project.
Yeah,
before we could get approval. So, I mean, the scope of the original, we ended up paying for a lot of it before they ever announced the funding. But yeah, we were looking at those numbers at the start of your term, but I can't remember anymore what they were.
So, I mean, that cost for option B is typical of increasing the berms by. Was it 3 meters?
2 meters.
2 meters. That's typically what that costs, so that's actually quite a pleasant surprise at this point.
Uh-huh.
So what direction are you wanting us to decide? We prefer option B tonight, or?
Well, just so that John can start work and Trevor can start working towards that option. Formally pass a resolution next meeting.
Great. So how do council feel about that?
Option B, I feel, is probably the most suitable.
And that was the original plan, so I believe that's the correct one.
What was the recommendation that was there?
From John's email?
Yeah.
both he and Trevor recommended option B, right?
Okay.
Do we need to pass that resolution sooner? Isn't it, the landfill's supposed to be filled by the end of the year?
Well, it's already within the project scope. I don't think we need a resolution for deciding which plan. We've already covered all of this in the scope of the project. We have the funding. We're not approving anything outside of the budget. It's,
great.
I think it's just making our decision.
Onward,
but
on which
yeah.
one? Okay.
But, I mean, yeah, maybe he wants direction because we're...
Let's go with B and let's get her done.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, review of bylaw 10-2023 trailer licensing and fees. So I've read the information you gave us. What there was some research done on what is being charged to other municipalities, and I couldn't dig that up today from.
From what I know of, Alexander and Lac de Bonnet are both charging $350 per site annually, and Broken Head is charging $125 per site.
So the first one is Alexander and Lac de Bonnet?
Yes.
Okay, thoughts?
Is there any other differences between those RMs and Rs in terms of the way they structure different fees, or is it pretty much the same where the campground owners pay tax and this is an additional fee, or?
No, it's based on services that are available to the campers.
Okay.
And in talking with Giselle about their bylaw, they support their fee based on what services are being provided, and I'm not sure what formula they apply it between the residents and the campers, but that's what they've worked out as a dollar amount.
Did you get into details of what their services are compared to ours or anything like that?
No, I could go further into.
When were the campground owners looking for a response? I know they were planning to communicate with their campers?
Yes, end of August.
They need to know by the end of August, kind of thing?
I was talking to Giselle today, and she said right now they're actually still talking to legal, so they're talking to Greg Tramley, and they just need to know that there's a correct reference to the Municipal Act, and they're doing an analysis on the justification, and Way to Go Consulting is doing that. So there has to be good justification for the increase in the price. So they are looking into that right now.
In Alexander.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
To charge the $350.
Oh, so they're not charging the $350?
Not yet. They're going through all of this still.
So what are they charging now? Do we know?
I didn't ask that. Sorry.
Okay.
Can you run us through that Excel spreadsheet, Giselle? Or, sorry, Trudy, just talking with yourself.
So these are the main services that are available to everybody in the community.
Mm-hmm.
And as during the summer months, of course, like there's no snow clearing in there because it's not relevant. And so the total cost per year based on last year's financials, and then just as a percentage, and it's all subjective as to what percentage you would use. Now this is for 25% of the year, so 3 months, and when you May to September, divide it down, and it still adds up to $415,000, but then I took by the number of houses and the number of campsites that are actually being used at that time of year for those 3 months, and that's 1,038, and that would come up to $400 per house or per site. But then if you consider maybe those campers are only there maybe Friday to Sunday, so then I split that down even further to only 0.13%. That was, I believe it was 42 days from May until September. And when you work it all down based on the same units of house and campsites, it's $208. So it depends what variables you want to use. Like I say, this is just my take on it, but
and that's, this spreadsheet is on a model where the services are equal across houses versus campsites?
Yes.
Okay, so breaking down services, like, so at my house I got garbage pickup once a week. Campground gets how much? Once a week
once
as well?
Once a week.
Once a week as well?
Mm-hmm.
What other services? So they don't have running water out there?
That's in this list though.
Well, utilities
but that's
are
a
separate.
Whole list of everything, right?
Like, utilities
well, not
are
everything.
Separate.
Yeah.
Utility users.
Utilities are a user pay.
Okay.
So they're not included.
So everybody is provided with police service if they need it or not, fire department service, emergency measure service, mosquito control, road maintenance.
So road
and that's...
That would be like grading. Is there grading that's been done for the campgrounds?
On, say, Willis Road and Alice Chambers Road.
So on the main roads?
Main
right.
roads.
Okay.
Yeah, not interior.
Okay.
Garbage pickup, nuisance grounds, that's all part of the garbage, recycling, processing recycling, community centers, that was, what was that part of? It's just a minor amount for the summer, swimming pool and beaches. So that's just a portion of the programming that is done there that's available to all the seasonal residents also. Playgrounds and parks, that's all available to everybody in the town. And other recreational facilities, there again, some are available to everybody.
Okay, so I'm more curious about, so Alexander's not charging that amount. We don't know what they're currently charging, if anything?
No, I thought they were charging that already.
Okay, and how about Lac de Bonnie?
They are $350.
And they are currently charging?
Yes.
Okay. Can you find out from Giselle or from Alexander what they're currently charging, if confirm whether what they're charging now? And so they went to their legal, Shannon, for opinion on this prior to changing anything?
Yep.
All right.
In rewriting their bylaw, I don't went through their lawyer.
Okay.
There's some issue if it's against the municipal law?
He clarified which sections. They were quoting the wrong section, and he just verified what the correct section they should be quoting in their bylaw.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
So it's not that they didn't have authority to do it, they were just using the wrong section.
Oh, it's just wrong language.
Yeah.
Okay.
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 Well, I don't see us jumping this up to $400 a site, and based on what I guess we should wait and see what Alexander's currently charging so we get a fair idea, and we can perhaps call a special meeting next week.
I think we're gonna have to, yeah, before August, the end of August, but we're gonna have to make a decision on this one way or another.
Right.
Yeah. The most practical goal would be maybe starting with a reasonable rate and then having a set amount of increments, say over the next 5 years.
It'd become part of our fee schedule so that we would actually analyze it every year, right?
Oh, yes, every year you could, yes.
I think that's the way to go.
Okay, yeah.
All right, any further discussion tonight?
No.
Okay.
Oh, one other item.
Sure.
The parking passes, we thought that those then would be given out just like they are to the residents. So that would be a $40 parking pass that would be included in their fee.
So once this is, whatever fee is decided, they would get that,
they would
get that green seasonal
them.
Pass and
yes.
they put in their vehicle just like residents.
Exactly.
Yeah, that makes sense.
That makes sense.
Okay, that's an important clarification. Okay, anything else?
No.
Okay. Welcome back. Okay, indemnity by-law. So I read through the St. Clements one, and I thought we should explain right up front that that by-law is, should have been revised. If you read the language there, talking about a third of it not being taxable, that's no longer applicable. The federal government used to have in the tax laws that municipal councillors got a third of their indemnities tax-free. And then they changed the laws, well, it was 8, 6, 7 years ago. And so that no longer, so anyway, that language in there you can ignore, is the total amount that matters as an annual indemnity. So that's virtually in every paragraph. So does it.
But you guys didn't take any, like you guys haven't done anything with this, correct?
No.
Yeah, so my only I wasn't suggesting that we adopt the St. Clements bylaw per se. There are pieces of it that I think that are good,
right.
Especially the explanation of what is covered under the monthly indemnity versus the daily. I think those are pieces that are question marks every time we have an election and councillors are wondering how to fill out timesheets and what we call certain meetings and what is considered part of our monthly indemnity versus the hourly. So to me, those are pieces that we would want to incorporate into our current indemnity bylaw. But I'm not saying there's anything wrong with our indemnity bylaw. To me, that would just enhance and make it a lot clearer.
Right. Yeah, I understood that. I just thought people are going to wonder what is going on with that language, so I thought I would explain.
For sure.
I didn't see the attachment from Crystal about the increase. Was that added?
Yeah.
That was added after.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh.
Remember, we were talking about
what
the budget would look like if we made an increase.
Mm-hmm.
Would this be for the next fiscal year?
No, it's current.
She did some calculations. So based on the original budget, that's in the top chart, and then that was including the 2% increase that was built into it. And then if you were to go with an overall 4.5%, so the bottom chart has the additional 2.5% built into it, and you and based on council plans coming up for September, October, November, December, So she did some calculations and it actually comes out to less than what the original budget was.
Well.
That would be based on absences.
Oh, leaves and everything else, okay.
So the piece that I think Blair spoke to last time was changing the monthly indemnity piece instead of just assuming the increase, but actually going outside of that and creating a larger, was that what you were suggesting?
Well, we've
Because we've added the second council meeting.
Greatly increased the workload.
Yeah, I mean, so your council meetings are part of your monthly indemnity, right? They're not billed under the hourly, so just understand that when you're looking at this, right? So if we went with a hybrid here of what's presented and we went outside, you know, we could go higher on our monthly and stick with a 2% on the hourly if we wanted to try and, you know, find a balance, but just then know that we're compensating ourselves for adding that second council meeting.
We have a second meeting now every month, yeah.
And the prep that we do for those meetings.
Well, the workload definitely has increased for sure.
Mm-hmm. So those are the pieces to think about when we look at changing, like approving an increase or not.
So do we have a resolution for the increase tonight?
Not for today.
No, we give, we give action to staff to develop a bylaw based on whatever guidance we get in tonight. That's what we've done in the past. So.
Okay.
Like I think the hybrid suggestion that Rhonda just made makes
a lot
of sense.
Yeah.
It actually reflects our workload.
So I think we tasked Crystal with kind of balancing that request, right? To try and live within her 4.5% projection, but increase that monthly indemnity more significantly than the 4.5, even if it means assuming less, down to even 2% on the hourly, so that we're compensating for the council meeting.
Is everybody okay with that guidance? Mm-hmm. Then when we actually get a draft bylaw, we can discuss
look
the details
at
that time.
Yeah.
And then, like, I just also asked staff then when they're looking at the wording to just consider adding wording around the difference between the monthly versus the daily in the indemnity bylaw, just so that we can just better clarify it, so if people are wondering.
Okay. Municipal capacity building fund. We didn't get it.
No, that was for the strategic plan.
Mm-hmm.
Disappointing news. I think we need to either find the funds to hire a consultant or go with Community Futures again, but I really strongly feel we should have probably already started strategic planning, so it would have been nice to have it done before we go to budget.
Uh-huh.
And as we know from going through strategic planning recently, it's a bit of a process.
Uh-huh.
Right? So I think the sooner we start it, the better. I mean, I thought Sherilyn did a great job with
The PCDC.
Yeah, with PCDC.
Yeah, sure.
That's probably our least expensive option. And as a first go of council, if she has time, I think I'd be in favor of trying to get the strategic planning done.
I agree. That'd be money well spent.
I don't know if we can get it in before budget, but.
Well, we don't actually have to finalize the budget until
you start it. Yeah, okay.
Right. So we make estimates and then amend the budget as we go through the process, right?
Okay.
So that's not as critical a timeline, but sooner rather than later is the guidance there, right?
Okay.
So can we action Judy to
reach out and get
some dates for strategic planning?
From Sherilyn?
Yes. Okay, and then the last item in the business arising is DEI and reconciliation training.
I'll have to say I was very surprised by the cost of the reconciliation training. $6,000 a day for two people. Council would indulge, I've got some connections with the community that I could probably provide different costs. Because I think we absolutely have to do the reconciliation training.
Yes.
And I know some people in the community that would come and give a very good presentation for, if you guys would indulge me to try to find some pricing and stuff. Like if that's what this is for, up to for discussion, but I think 6,000 a day is a lot for two people to come. I think we could spend that money wiser and some better training.
Yeah, I would support looking at options. Okay.
There's no specific municipal guidelines in terms of acquiring a trainer, like there's no...
No, it is so vague. I'm just surprised nobody is out there, like AMM sourcing people, because everybody needs the same training, but...
It's one of the calls to action, and I can't believe that there's nothing set up yet for that, so... Okay, I'll reach out to some elders and stuff that I know, and we'll see what I can find.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm just gonna take a quick break, please. RA report?
Okay, so starting with grants, the status, we have still one grant application outstanding, that's the riprap along the Winnipeg River, and we have not heard anything on that application yet. And the strategic plan, of course, we just received notice that that was not successful. There was a trails accessibility grant for the parking lot that I was going to do, but in talking with Marcia and Nancy, they discouraged me because they didn't said it would not fit the grant criteria because that portion of the trail is actually mixed use, not just pedestrian or bicycle trail. So we did not apply for that one. Projects, pool house, mechanical, HVAC, plumbing, electrical, actually Rudy Clausen and Jeff Harding and I were able to finally meet today, and we went through the drawings and the schedules quite thoroughly, so I will submit all the concerns and amendments to the MIR contract or consultants who were hired to do the drawings, and then we can get a quick turnaround on that. A lot of it was just housekeeping, some just minor concerns, but I'll get that done first thing tomorrow morning. Just so you can see how busy I have been, just meeting after meeting, and also always on call for security, meeting with people who had concerns about their assessment because Board of Revision is coming up, and the deadline was yesterday to get their appeals in, and we do have 8 registered for appeal.
Wow. We haven't had a lot like that in years.
No, it's,
well, by the time the meeting comes, there may be a,
right,
there
right.
will be a
the
smaller
assessor
number.
Will,
because
the work
was
all of them. That's a big number.
Well, that was a big jump in assessment.
Yeah. Well, these are their next year's taxes, all right?
Wow.
Yeah.
Because people do not realize when they received their assessment notice last year,
mm-hmm.
how it would affect their taxes until they actually got their tax bill this
mm-hmm.
year.
Right.
And
yeah.
they were quite surprised. Okay, so we had Voyager houseboats come in, and they are very concerned about the weeds that are in the marina, and they would like them cut because there's potential to damage their marine equipment. They're continuously having to remove the weeds that are getting sucked in on their jet ski or wrapping around props. And I reached out to, that's further down. So then we go on to August 14th. We had the half review Friday, no, August 15th, I had met with Rick Backer and with Giselle. Did a weed inspection. There's some, someone was concerned there were noxious weeds at the school property, but they are not a noxious weed. They're just called mullein. It's a tall plant with flowers on it, very slow growing, doesn't seed out very quickly. Been very busy with parking tickets, screening requests for cancellations, and let's see, I've been locking up the sundial bathrooms at night time, but now Audrey is back, and she'll be doing that. I've reached out to Crown Lands about the public reserve land, and they are still waiting for an updated ministerial order before they can proceed with transferring the public reserves to the LGD. Lights for Aberdeen Avenue north of Burroughs Hydro, they just provided nothing detailed other than an estimate of $1,800 per street light, so I will have to go out and do a count how many street lights there are. So if you were interested in doing every light or every second light, this was from a request from somebody, I think it was early.
So wasn't this request to put one at the corner of like Cameron and Aberdeen?
Well, I thought it was for all along Aberdeen.
All along.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because it would be very costly. That's a long stretch. So
right.
I just want to count the number of poles and see.
Yeah, like I don't know that we would do the entire, I mean, all those people wouldn't want lights in their backyard if it's, But the intersection for sure.
The intersection is different, yeah. And then if that land ever got developed, that would be different. But
yeah.
Right now, it's just bush on both sides. For
yeah,
most
I
of
mean,
it.
You have the light at the corner of 211, and then it's like pitch
yeah.
black.
Yeah, I think the one corner maybe, but
okay,
yeah.
Is it just Cameron and Aberdeen?
Yeah, I mean one, maybe two lights at most, I would think. But
is it a walking issue? Like people were? Is it a safety issue? Because I know people do walk on.
I do. Is there one, what's the street called? Where the new development is, I just blanked. Is there one there?
Trillium?
At Trillium? Is there one there?
Well, I think they have one within their property.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's,
yeah,
a
it's a little bit set anymore.
That they put in, yeah. And that's also closer to the 211.
So let's refer this to budget.
Yeah.
Right?
Uh-huh.
Sure.
Okay,
so I've been meeting with the new rec coordinator. We're trying to get her set up, and the art gallery people were quite excited to have her set up there, but she spent Friday in the office, and they have the reception table here and the rec coordinator table here, and their chairs hit. And there's just no privacy, it's not workable. So yesterday we went to the rec coordinator office by the library, and that will be suitable. There will be enough activity going on that she can engage with people and get the feel of what they're looking for, also engage a bit with the students, try and find out what they would like to see for programming, because there is probably the target of, say, the 12 to 14 year olds that really don't have much going on. So
probably a good spot, yeah.
Yeah, so
so we've come full circle.
Absolutely, yeah. So at least that was settled.
And we'll put a public notification where the office is and stuff.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. And we'll try and have two regular days, like maybe a Tuesday and a Friday, that she would have morning office hours guaranteed those days.
Good idea.
The rest would probably be kind of flexible hours. Okay, and then, yes, Pierre was back from Voyager Houseboats, and he wants to know what we are going to do about the weeds. Public Works says that they just do not have the equipment to remove weeds and also the manpower at this point. They are down quite a few staff. And there was a contraption that was bought a few years ago, and it's a weed cutter. And that's all that they have, but they don't have, all you'd be able to do is stand on the shoreline and just pull it.
Yeah, I've seen them use that a couple years ago.
Yeah.
And then there was complaints still from some people that they were some special, and I don't know who the individual was, but saying that they're special plants that were killing and stuff, so there was like, I know that was shut down. So, yeah. I mean, I'm in the marina too. It's bad.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I went through there, and yeah, it's pretty bad. So, so I don't know if there's other options that we should reach out to get estimates, if we could contract with somebody who has some sort
of weed
removal equipment.
We used to dredge here, is what I was told. Every
no,
no. Well, someone that lived in town said they used to way back in the day.
Well, it's been at least 25 years
a long time
since
ago.
The marina has been dredged.
Yes. What's the cost of that? Is that pretty expensive? Mm-hmm. Do you guys have a number?
About
you know?
Half a bill.
Yeah, we had an estimate many years ago.
We did when we were looking at possibly expropriating it. We had an estimate done at that time, and that reduces the value of trying to buy it, but. In the end, the offer we made was rejected. But we, at that time, we did the exercise of getting an estimate of how much it would cost.
What I could do is reach out to the company that now owns the amphibexes, because I know in the parks they were hired to go and dredge all the channels. This was about 3 years ago.
Okay.
So I believe the costs have come down.
Maybe there's better equipment. Yeah.
The
at least do the main lines. Like
yes.
Know. Like maybe not every little marina slip, but at least get the main.
What about like our little unit that we put at the beach? How is that performing?
The aerators? Well, Shannon and I were there probably about 3 weeks.
It was just the week before the birthday.
Okay, birthday weekend, yeah. See, I don't know what it would look like without them, so I can't really say. There were weeds there, but that is also, somebody mentioned the water flows have changed because of Puka Island being in the water now. So
that's true.
I say if you can get a quote, that would be good from that company.
Yes.
Let's start there and see if...
Well, and I also wonder if there's any, like... I don't know, organics or something that you can put in the water that, you know.
Environmentally friendly stuff, yeah.
Yeah, that
I could reach out to
away that stuff.
Something, yeah.
Maybe Jeff Long.
Like, I don't know if it's similar to like a lagoon and the kind of.
Yeah, there's not enough water actually
in
there,
a lagoon,
right? Yeah.
Right? But you can put stuff in a lagoon.
And the water's super low right now, though, too, which
doesn't
help. But.
Yeah, I think the issue is because of fish.
You're
really
restricting. You have to be really careful what you do.
Yes,
100%. But I think there are organics, but I don't know if they would work in the marina or not.
It's a good start.
Okay. So we'll get a quote on potential dredging.
Yes, we've had excessive amount of parking violations are being challenged this last week, so that's gonna keep me busy tomorrow.
So what's the basis for the challenges?
They buy their stub from security, and then when the person on from security is walking through checking, I guess because it was so windy, a lot of people's stubs blew off their windshields onto their floor, or they or if they just didn't put them on their dashboards, and so they received tickets, and they sent me a copy of their stub from security, a copy of their parking ticket, and
I mean, that could be sketchy too, right?
I know, there's
so part of
they
when you
share tickets.
Yeah, part of when you buy a ticket is it says must be displayed in the windshield.
And we have
and if not,
we have that signage going
right,
into the
but that's all I'm
lot.
Saying. So
yeah.
So some of these, you know, the onus is on the person to properly display their ticket. You close your door, you walk away. Is my ticket there or isn't it? Like
leave your windows closed.
Yeah, I mean it's no different than
we write the
date
on them,
it.
But it doesn't say
okay.
anywhere on it. It has to be displayed on
no,
the,
it doesn't
on
say
the dash.
But where would you? I mean, that's what needs to be clear then.
Yeah,
is,
and the
it's
signage driving
ticket.
In does say you have to display.
How many do you have to look at, approximately?
I believe I'm getting about 10 of them now, just from this past weekend. So
I think, going forward, we should probably put. A blurb on here that says must be displayed on dash.
Face up on dash, like you're in a parking
ticket.
Yeah.
I'm not sure what the electronic ones say. Can they come out of the machine?
Yeah, I'd have to look at one to see.
Maybe that would help with the.
Is anybody paying their fines?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yes,
yep.
We are doing quite well, and we have to follow up with the ones who haven't, and.
That's good.
See where it goes from there, but we've had quite exciting return.
and the person we hired to check tickets when the security aren't there, how's that going?
Oh, she is awesome.
That's
yeah.
how we're getting some of our.
Yeah, I know.
Yes,
good.
Yes. As soon as she had sort of a uniform style, and as soon as she put that on, totally professional.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Excellent.
So I do have a question. So Highways agreed to put up their signage that basically marks the,
mm-hmm.
I don't know what it is, 50 meters or whatever, around the intersection, right, that you're not allowed to park in. And they have their signage there. But we're starting to get the offenders now that are parking literally within those limits again. So most of the people do cross the road and stay on Willis. But we are getting now for the last two weekends, there's been people parking with like on the highway within the clearly marked by highways, no parking allowed. So I guess my question, I think I know the answer, we wouldn't have jurisdiction to put a notice on there. But I wonder if we could, I wonder if we should consider then having something different that we print up to educate people, you are in a no parking zone.
Well, I do have warning tickets that I had made up, so.
Because, I mean, they're clearly in an area where there's a sign that says you can't park here. So even though we might not have jurisdiction
mm-hmm.
to ticket them, I think us putting a notice on their vehicle, it says you're parked where you can't be parked. I don't know. I mean, to me, because it's the same thing, right? One person does, and as soon
mm-hmm.
as one person does,
yes.
everybody goes, oh, well, I guess you can park here. What's the difference, right? And it's been some larger vehicles, so. You know, a vehicle with a boat or a vehicle with a trailer, and it's right at the intersection. So I mean, that causes those points where you lose your sight lines, right? And there's so much traffic that's at that four-way point, and then you got big things blocking the view. It's just a nightmare. But
yeah, if it's highway traffic that you can't park there, then we also have to have the RCMP know then to come deal with it.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's typically the weekends, right, where the parking lot fills and then people. But I mean, I
but
just
they
noticed
park
the
down
last
on the
couple
road that
weekends.
They can park on, right?
Yeah,
oh,
yeah,
for
walk
sure.
Further.
Walk further.
Yeah. But I've it's really only noticed it the last couple weekends, so.
Yeah, earlier I didn't notice it wasn't bad
no.
at all. So.
No.
Okay.
Would it be possible, Trudy, obviously this bylaw officer has started, right?
Enforcement officer, yes.
Enforcement officer?
Yes.
Just to have a small little report on a blurb on like what hours she's working,
okay,
how many tickets, just something, some data on, yeah, I guess, I don't know what shouldn't be included in that, but her hours, I guess, how many tickets she's issuing. Just a...
You turned on an investment.
Yeah, just sort of a little blurb on how that is going and like what areas she's patrolling.
Yeah, so is it, has she just been doing so far the parking?
We did have her at the Marina, but then we found out our payment system that is through the website does not work. And Shannon's been working on trying to get that up and running again.
Mm-hmm.
But I know her presence was definitely at the Marina also.
Okay. But so we had talked about giving her like a couple of bylaws to have her look at,
mm-hmm,
and kind of study up on. I know her time is short here now anyways, but just wondering if there was any flavor to go beyond.
Yeah, now that parking will be done,
down,
mm-hmm, I think then we can focus on some of those
100%,
others.
Yeah.
Okay.
And she was keen to do it when we talked to her, so.
Oh, yes. Yes, I had given her some bylaws to read over,
okay,
but we
good
haven't sat down and gone through them.
Yeah, show her how to enforce it, what to do, and yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So I'm making progress in my office, and the girls are quite surprised some days. They can't recognize it.
Good work, Trudy.
Oh, I hate to part with my paper.
Just know it'll always be here with you.
It's somewhere here, don't worry.
Okay, good report. I don't think any of us doubted you were busy, so, but it's
yeah, when
I
just
started,
well, I'm just
going to
see, because what do I do all week that I'm not getting anything done? And
I like seeing it like this.
Yeah, it's
like
good.
I like
good report.
Knowing how
you... Just, we skipped over John's estimate on the three-car parking
ooh
lot.
Right.
Yes.
For Willis West.
It's a second attachment there, too,
mm-hmm,
which...
Yeah.
Is that where it's anyways?
Yes.
So that came in at a better price, right? Than what?
Well, it's just a three car.
No, yes,
just
yeah,
three car.
Yeah, yeah, and like he says, he's hoping that he could also utilize CNL training opportunity.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So
we talked about that.
Yeah.
So it might come down on the cost, but
yeah, if you take out the hourly rate, yeah,
880. We only had about 4,000, though, didn't we?
I think so.
Will that have to go on?
I think we talked about 4,000.
The next agenda for a resolution?
For me?
Will that have to go on the next agenda for a resolution, to pass a resolution?
Because it's above budget, you mean? Is that what you mean?
Well, I don't think we actually passed a resolution saying.
I can't remember what we actually passed.
We were looking to get an estimate to do it like this, so yeah, I think that's the answer. We have to get to a resolution at the next meeting.
Yeah, okay.
So, okay. And now we have some good estimates. Okay, on to new business. So I typed up my notes today for a meeting with Awanipark that Trudy and I had a week ago Friday. So generally the issue is that, and I guess if we go back, there was a time when the residents in a water park paid a different taxation rate basically because we were paying for water and sewer through our municipal taxes here in town, and they didn't have water and sewer, so there was a separate bylaw that said actually the people in the town side pay a different tax rate than the people in the water park. That's the way it was set up. So when we installed water meters, that really basically changed that. And when we started analyzing what was the difference in services that were being provided to Awanipark, there were minimal differences. So we basically rescinded that bylaw, and now everybody gets paid the same taxation rate What has happened over the years is that as a number of residents grew in Awanipark, the provision of services to them were generally not provided with a sufficiently high priority to match the property taxes that they're paying. And so the residents there are saying it's about time we change that. And they were considering going through an appeal of their taxes to force the issue, but instead they decided to meet with us to see if we could work out some way of getting the services that they're paying for in a timely manner. And so we agreed to meet with them. And you saw my notes, so they're very happy with snow removal and the garbage and recycling is good. But the maintenance of the road has been sporadic. And again, I think it's never been given, the public works managers have never been given direction that you need to be spending so much of time and dollars at a water park because they're paying the same rate of taxes as everybody else.
Yeah.
It's just one of those things that grew and grew to be more of a problem than it originally was. And now it's time that we started treating them differently. So the road maintenance, there was sometimes no gravel delivered. Or if it was, it wasn't very good. No dust control. And they've done grass cutting there once this year. There's a couple. They're claiming there's drainage and ditches that has been blocked because of the installation of the water lines. And I mean, that's a job for John to go out and look at with Chuck and decide what we can do about that. They said the drainage swales, there's drainage swales that need to be brushed every 3 years, and I think we thought we had the right equipment to do that now. And so we could that would be a low-hanging fruit job we could go and do there fairly soon. We talked about with the fire chief about fire suppression. Uh-huh. Septic charges, when we changed the bylaw, we wrote them a letter, Giselle wrote them a letter, and we approved it that said that they would not have to pay for septic charges, but that really was a mistake. That should not have been in there, but it is in there. And so we're going to, we've discussed this in the past and said we have to stand firm. People in Pinamar are paying for their septic charges, and so will Awanipark. So, that's going to be part of the letter that we write them, I think, that they won't like. We started talking about bylaw enforcement, particularly encroachment at our planning meeting, so that's another area they're looking for help.
But I think on that bylaw enforcement piece, I don't know that we resolved it because our legal opinion is that we shouldn't be enforcing bylaws there.
Yeah, because it's a condominium corporation, right? Mm-hmm.
And so I know that, there's mixed opinions on that, but I don't know that it's wise to seek a legal opinion and then disagree with them.
We actually have a legal opinion saying that already?
The letter's attached.
And have we shared that with them directly?
Well, I mean, on the planning committee we did. They
so,
didn't like that out.
So the thing is, we have done bylaw enforcement there in the past. And, for example, when people were building temporary buildings or and then running power to them and living there for a while, we actually went on the letter writing campaign and eliminated all that problem. So we did that. Waterpark didn't do it.
It was municipal bylaws, though. You can enforce those in there.
Right. Yes. And that's all I'm not suggesting we go outside the municipal bylaws. They were started an argument about the road not being paved, and so they should get a tax break. And I explained to them they are getting a tax break, and I think Murray laughed when I explained it to him. He said, "Yeah, you're right." But anyway, I'm just sharing the conversation.
Mm-hmm.
And they would like a council to go out and have a tour in there once in a while to see what's going on. And they also asked for a letter from council describing the changes that will be implemented to elevate the priority of Awanipark to the same level as for the town site. And so my suggestion is that we actually set a separate public works budget for Awanipark, and that it become part of our monthly public works committee reports to talk about what's being done at Awanipark. I that elevates it to the level of scrutiny that that means that we're not going to go for a few months without ever talking about what needs to be done in Awanipark, right? Which is what's been allowed to happen. And nobody, not with any intention or anything, it's just people have set priorities based on day-to-day stuff without thinking about outside of town. So that's my summary of the meeting. Rather than go through an appeal of taxes process, they accepted basically my word that we would have this discussion and that we would look at providing a better level of service than we've done in the past. They accepted that as being good enough.
Well, and another little hanging fruit would be CNL said they have a grader and like they can run it right down there and do that piece like regularly if they wanted some gravel. So that's an easy one as well.
Absolutely, and at the time we had the meeting, we hadn't talked with CNL yet, so
otherwise no, so that's perfect. Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm open to questions on the meeting we had, and yes, Sue.
I like your idea of a separate budget line for Awanipark, so we can track how much we are spending there. Just looking at some of the things on the list, because I don't have past history, but like about the amount of gravel that goes on the roads. I mean, I'd like to know, I guess, from the public works, do we regularly add gravel to the gravel roads in Pinawa? And we're not doing it in Awanipark. And the dust control, do we do dust control on our gravel roads in town?
Yes.
Supposed to do it annually, yeah. It was just literally late this year.
Okay.
Yeah.
And we're not doing it at Awanipark.
Well, it's not that we haven't, yeah. It's been hit and miss with Awanipark, right? So.
Okay.
It sounds like looking for one in spring, and that seems easy peasy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So do we have our own truck for that dust control, or do we bring somebody else?
No, we hire somebody.
Well, so it's just including them in the contract?
Mm-hmm. Right.
They
felt like if you put down gravel in the spring and graded and put dust control on it, that might be all you have to do all year.
Right.
So what happened late last summer, right before our previous public works manager left, is he decided to do gravel our Willis West and Awanipark. And the material was terrible. I was out there and it was awful. It was basically sand. It washed away. It did nothing. So that's, I think, the piece that they're looking for is quality material, not just a lift, but quality material that's gonna actually hold up for the season. So.
Well, then I was thinking about in the long term, like we did chip seal along Willis Drive west of Aberdeen, and it seems to be holding up pretty good, which means if we did that over time, and that took over I think 3 years maybe it took us to build that up, it might mean that in the long run the amount of effort needed to maintain the roads might actually decrease. I'm just throwing that out there for John to have a look at and consider as an option. But
I think the piece that we need to establish is what the yardage is that we're going to be delivering each year, and then, you know, the cost for the dust control.
And we have to include it in the budget.
Mm-hmm.
So refer it to Public Works first to get an estimate of what we need, and then the budget after that. I like this idea, though.
Okay.
But I do have to caution, normally with a Bearland condominium development, they are responsible for everything within there, the roads, the ditches. In Reynolds, we have one, and we do not go on that private property to do any maintenance work. They have to hire all their own.
But they're paying the same property taxes as everybody else, right? So,
yes.
And we did the same thing with Dalhousie, whatever it is. What's that subdivision called? Pinawa Landing, yes, thank you. I mean, they're, it's still a privately owned road, but we still, we plow the roads. We put dust control on there when, occasionally, but we did, because they're paying high property taxes like everybody else, so.
I thought we made him pay for the dust control, or we did.
Well, whatever, we organized it.
Yeah.
We definitely didn't charge him for plowing the roads, and so.
I think the piece that we should have a little more investigation on when you have spare time, Judy, is with municipal services to understand, like, you know, whether or not that was the right move to make at that time, when we, in changing that taxation and what was promised to that group, if that makes sense, given it's a bare land condo agreement.
Yes, and Roger did comment, I don't know if you'd want to do this one in camera.
Probably.
It's a legal matter, so.
Yes.
Okay, so we'll leave it there for now.
Yeah. Well, and I did talk to Public Works about doing the swales and step up maintenance, that would be going forward, and they've actually been keeping track, and they have been there more times than Chuck let on.
I'm sure that's true.
Yeah.
Okay.
But what's missing is you can't see it in our financials.
No.
And if we send them a report saying this is what we spent on Awanipark this year versus budget, then there'll be no questions asked after that, right? Okay, administration training sessions in Lac-de-Bonnet.
That's just some information. I've signed Shannon and myself up to go to this training session. October for 2 days. I think they're on Thursdays.
Okay. Any discussion? The next item is Canadian Association of Nuclear Host Communities. So this is a meeting, we normally meet at the Canadian Nuclear Association annual conference as during that week, but there is a second meeting being organized for September 20th, and I've organized my holiday around being there for that. It's going to be held at the Nuclear Waste Management Organization facility in Oakville, and they've built a mock-up of what the, some of the, how the deep geological repository is going to work. So we're going to get a tour to start with that. So this is for information. I've will be asking for travel expenses from Manitoba to Ontario, but I am making time to be there. On a related note, with regards to nuclear, I'm being interviewed by a municipal leader, AMM magazine, tomorrow morning, about the SMR project. They're got wind of what we're working on here and are really interested in it, so I'm going to be interviewed in the morning about the project. And also there is there is a conference in Ignis in September, mid-September. I sent that out as well. Initially, it looked to me like it was just a trade show, but David Dabney and I had a conference call with him last weekend. It actually is a full conference, so there are going to be sessions both days. And David and I will be making a presentation on Saturday sometime about, so I'm going to start with a history of P Benoit and how we got to know about Starcore Nuclear, and then David's going to talk about the demonstration reactor. I'm looking for, I think Nuclear Waste Management Organization will reimburse me for my expenses to be there in person, but I haven't got a response on that yet. But I'm not too concerned about the cost. If I, it's my own dime, that's fine. I think this is really important because I realized in the discussion with them, they're also in Treaty 3. And so this is going to be an opportunity to network with the Grand Council of Treaty 3 people that are going to be there. I think that I don't even know how to measure that opportunity. So I've rearranged my holidays again to be there for those 2 days. And I was in Ignis 6 years ago. I met with their committee and made a presentation on what it's like to live in a nuclear community, and the Nuclear Waste Management Organization person, his name is Chantel, said that she was there for that committee meeting. There were like 25 people there, so I couldn't remember everybody's name, but anyway, she was there, and so she seemed to be quite keen on having somebody there during the conference that has familiarity with living in a nuclear community, because right now they're in the final stages. It's between them and Bruce, South Bruce, to make a compelling case for public support within the next year. And anyway, that's how that conference call went. So if there are any questions about any of that? Okay, Municipal Economic Development Infrastructure Program.
Okay, this is another grant program that has been circulated.
It looks promising.
Yes, public safety, disaster prevention, mitigation, climate resiliency, fire stations and related capital projects, roads, bridges, active transportation, multi-module transportation, solid waste management, and organic waste diversion. So I haven't read through it all, but definitely something to look at.
Yeah, I briefly read it. Did you catch whether it's like, can you only go one stream, or are you allowed to kind of, do you know?
I haven't gone through it.
Just send money.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm just thinking about the fire truck, I'm thinking about the roads, there's so much.
I looked through it and the fire truck to me qualified.
Mm-hmm.
I meant to ask Mike about that actually when he was here. But I mean the roads too.
Roads for sure, yeah.
It's not just regular maintenance. So.
Plus there's also a per capita funding piece that you can apply for. Outside of the meet-in?
I think that, does that not just come if it's per capita, right? Just get that, right?
It says, in addition to meet-in, one-time funding of $40 million will be allocated to municipalities on a per capita basis.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think we have to apply for that.
No, that just comes? Okay.
Because this was the gas tax.
Oh, that's a replacement for that.
Yeah.
Well, anyways, we've got to read it more, but look good.
So we'll have to figure out what the, we have until October 15th or something like that, right? So we'll have to set some priorities by at our next council meeting. Okay, any further discussion? Okay, weeds in Marina, we already talked about.
Yeah, just Public Works saying they really don't have the resources.
News articles cited, these are things I came across I thought might be of interest to council.
Yeah, so.
Particularly the one about the searching of landfills, I thought, found that to be an intriguing.
I thought that was a different take on it, for sure.
Mm-hmm. Can is a year-round location with water supply?
Yeah. Yes, so Sean is looking for a year round, he probably wouldn't be operating January, February, but he wants to be operating his pizza trailer right through December and start up again probably March. It's all insulated, but having a source of running water and access to sewer would be the key. So
access to
that,
sewer.
The site where he is right
he said
now.
Power. Power and water. He didn't say anything about
sewer.
Oh,
okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know if he's what his plan is for the sewage, but the water source where he is right now would not be available come freezing.
So he did contact the arena. He said you guys suggested the arena.
Yes, I did.
What?
I said, yeah, between the arena and the school, I thought perfect. Right?
So I just said to him, like, I mean, we would have to discuss it as a board because we rely on the canteen as an income stream, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I shared that with him already, and I said that we would have a board meeting to discuss, and he understands. He says he wants to contribute to the fundraising.
Yes.
So
he did say that.
He
yes.
said, you know, he'll put together a proposal once he sort of knows what we want, but yeah, it's for the board to debate and kick around.
Is that the only location we're looking at?
Shannon's driveway.
Yeah, I said my driveway. Yeah.
Well, I mean, if, like, I don't know what kind of, I don't think he's noisy or anything. Like, I don't think that's an issue because he's running just a regular, like, he's not running a generator, I don't believe. This is like a regular power supply. So, I mean, technically, down by the washroom buildings is power and water, right?
Mm-hmm. Is there not power there, right where the food trucks are?
Yeah, but not water.
Not during the winter, though.
I'm confused by the ask. Is he asking?
He needs water.
Like us to provide the water or provide another spot?
No, just recommend another
spot
or... You know, if there could be upgrades, I wouldn't be surprised if he would contribute.
Mm-hmm.
But just to try and get thoughts, are there better locations that would suit his needs?
Does his MOU cover him to operate outside of
I
certain months?
Just
his vendor fee, like all that
September,
stuff?
September, I believe, is the end.
So there's other things we have to look at?
I'd be okay with extending the time in his current location because he's just opening.
Absolutely.
Yeah, he hasn't been there all summer, correct?
Right.
Yeah. His
problem
is
with that water.
Yeah, that's his problem. It's a seasonal water line.
Oh, I understand that.
Yeah. So, I mean,
I don't think
he,
we can come up with a permanent other solution than before the snow flies. We have a lot of other things to work on, too, so.
Well, I don't know how hard, I don't think it would be that hard next to the, like, the services are there already.
Well, how do you keep it from freezing when you're not running?
That's what I'm wondering, because
yeah.
I've never
you
seen the trailer.
You can't just run the hose out, though.
No, can't be exposed, because then when he shuts down for the night, the water line's full, he's going to drain it every night. Like, I don't know how he operates this machine.
Yeah, he's got a holding thing for
Does
his
he just
water.
Have a holding tank?
Yeah, like, for his water, and then it, yeah.
So he fills the holding tank?
Yeah,
kind of
thing, yeah. From what I'm understanding from
the
And
then he has heat in the trailer that keeps the holding tank
right.
from freezing.
Right.
Okay.
Well, then he can just. We shut down.
But we shut that down, yeah.
So we'd have to move it to fill it.
Which he doesn't want to do.
Which you don't want to do, really.
So you want to be close to a tap.
Yeah.
Where you can run a hose to it, fill your
right.
tank.
Mm-hmm.
You just got to close and then off.
Right.
What about the parking lot here?
I know, I did think of that actually.
I mean, the other place I've thought about is Vanier as well. I know residents weren't happy about having a food truck in that area. Well, nobody wants a food truck in their neighborhood, right? But the noise was a concern for sure, and that's why I was saying he probably wouldn't have noise, right? So, I mean, at the back of that parking lot, maybe, or somewhere. I mean, it's a potential location.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I'm assuming the electrical isn't just a regular 110, it has to be
like a 50, yeah, it's just like a regular
So it'd be like a trailer, like a camping trailer, 50, one of those three prong plugs.
Yeah.
Well, those
yeah.
aren't just everywhere though.
Mm-hmm. No.
It happens
like a stove plug, yeah.
Yeah, so we'd have to wire something.
I don't know that that's not there already. Not outside the yeah. Something would have to be Yeah, he said just a regular stove plug, 50 amp.
Yeah, so that's not an outdoor plug or anything that you can use. You have to have special electrical for that.
Yeah, I can see that being a logistical problem with the menu. So
but he
is
would
there
have
other
to,
activities
he would
going
have
on?
Pay.
Pardon?
He would pay that.
He would pay the fee to do it. Yeah, no, I'm
yeah.
just saying all the things we're going to have to do.
No, I meant logistics with other things that are going on at the venue center.
Oh. Yeah, I mean, to me, this is a straightforward one. We had a food truck down here before. There's water and power here, but...
He has been talking to Alex.
Yeah, going on Alex's lunch.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're going to consider it at the arena and...
And then wherever else he proposes.
Might want to just clarify the water thing, because we're concerned about how that's going to work. If you could. Okay, any other discussion tonight? Okay, fire department report, we already had a really good review of that tonight, so. With regards to the request about continuing the training, I personally think it'd be wrong to stifle the momentum that he's built up there. And if it's only a couple $1,000s over the fire department budget, I have zero problem with that myself. That's money well spent.
I agree.
Yeah, so one of my actions was to go back with Mike, get a clear number for you guys on exactly what the ask would be, and we'll just bring it forward.
Yeah, because he talked about $8,000 over budget if we continued with the training, then he talked about $2,000 over budget.
Yeah, I wasn't quite
so
clear.
Because
some of it he could defer to the next year, he said,
yeah,
so
yeah.
I wasn't, I think we just need to get a...
Right, philosophically, we're supportive.
Yes.
I think the offsetting thing is the money he's invoicing, which we've never had before, and I doubt that was in our budget.
And I believe that is currently at $17,000 that he has collected on fire calls.
Because he said $9,000 in his report.
I think that's
is what
outstanding.
He's in
what is, outstanding.
Oh, outstanding. Oh, okay.
Anyway, we have that revenue that we've never had before, so and is not in our budget, I'm pretty sure.
No.
So I think that's where it comes out to a net of $2,000. But I'm certainly okay with you clarifying.
Yeah, let's clarify.
But philosophically, we're supportive.
He's doing a lot of good work there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I will get Crystal to send you some current numbers.
Yeah, what he's at, what he's spent.
Yeah,
okay.
Revenue.
Okay, Pinawa Lions Club, thank you for the birthday weekend support. That's for everybody to have a pleasant read. I think we're the ones that should be thanking them, which we do.
Okay,
fires by pool and at beach. And at the picnic pergola as well, once before at least.
Do we have signage to open fires down at the beach?
I don't believe so.
Yeah, we need a few more signs in that area, but from the chatter on Facebook, I haven't been at the beach this summer, but I don't think this was open fires. I think this was people dumping their charcoal briquettes after. I think it's kind of hard to tell though. After they had, little hibachi barbecues, and then they want to go home, so they just dump them out.
Yeah.
Well, it was open fire at the pergola.
At the pergola, yeah.
Yeah.
and that's what it looked like, so.
That's my first thought, oh God, now we have to put up a whole other set of new signage saying no fires permitted.
Well, I mean, I know when I taught, yeah, I mean, I remember bringing that up and that was your first comment and so I wondered even like something to talk about with Mike too, because we never did get anywhere with our, like our fire pit bylaw, right? So even when I was telling those people at the Purtill, I'm like, we don't allow open fires and they're, you know, kind of questioning me on, you know. And I said, no, there's a bylaw in town that doesn't allow it, whatever. But, I mean, if we had the bylaw that was clear and just posted the sign at each of the pergola areas and stuff, I mean, then it begs the question, do you want to allow hibachis and stuff? Because they do, I mean, there was a group that was between the pergola and the marina this past weekend, just in the grassy area, and they had the whole gamut going as well in a contained, but still, like it's just grass area, like it's kind of dangerous because we're not, like typically you would be doing that over a sand surface or something, not just a grassy area.
Do you have any intel, Shannon, on this, if it was open fire or hot coal or?
No, I just can't imagine that the people at the pool would allow. Like, we just have a lot of people down at the beach. How would they not, someone not say something?
Yeah, I think this
so
is
that's
some people.
Why.
I think this is charcoal from,
yeah.
And they just dumped.
I'm trying to zoom in on the picture.
Yeah.
It looks like charcoal chunks to me that
yeah.
have been dumped out of a barbecue. But either way.
I mean.
Right, well, I don't think we want really that going on in the
no.
park
no.
either, right?
No, you have
no.
kids running around.
No, that's it's
yeah.
dangerous. I mean, at what point do we entertain actually like having some of these, I don't know what they're called, I've seen them before, you know, they're on a post,
oh,
cast iron, so people can have a proper place if they want to have a little.
Like set up our own barbecues?
Yeah.
But that's the piece, right? That's what they said to me, are you planning on putting a pit here so that people can barbecue? And I said, no. And he said, why not? And I said, because. I said, we don't have adequate support. We're at a high fire risk in our community already. We don't have adequate support to manage an open fire.
Well, I think open fires are different than the charcoal barbecue.
Yeah, I mean.
On the cement pergola, maybe.
Or down at the beach area where I think most people would probably make use of those. Like building fire pits, I don't know about that.
Mm-hmm.
But the charcoal barbecues.
And then it becomes complicated because then people bring a gas barbecue. Like, what is the rule going to be? Like, are you going to allow barbecuing or not?
Mm-hmm.
Open fires or not? Fire pits or not? And if you're going to have charcoal, then a charcoal bin is a good idea. I mean, it's a
how far do you go?
It's
yeah.
a big discussion.
Mm-hmm. It is.
Mm-hmm.
But we have this problem. We have lots of visitors
mm-hmm.
coming to the beach, and I mean.
So if you put the coal bin out, you're encouraging.
I don't think we do
that.
Nothing, right?
Right.
So
if you put one of those out. Then that means you're encouraging that, or not encouraging it, but you're allowing it.
This is an app, like, this is what Gimli has done.
Right.
My feeling is that we don't want to encourage any barbecuing fires of any kind.
Mm-hmm.
Propane or hibachi or Coleman or whatever. That's not the intent of our park or our beach.
Yeah, and that's fine if that's what council decides, but then we gotta put signs up and
we have to enforce it.
And then start, well.
Well, we have a person that we hire to do that. I mean, that could be one of the things they watch for, right?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that's the piece, is we have to establish what we, you know, that we don't allow those fires or whatever, and then, yeah, just have the person patrolling those areas.
You do have a fire pit over at the sailing docks.
Private property. It's theirs.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm just
wilderness
saying.
Edge.
Yeah. Yeah.
No,
just
it's
saying
private
that
property
is
though.
There, though. But
and
yeah, and they
the
have one here because it's also their property.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But
yeah,
people
absolutely.
Think it's public property, but it's not. It's on Wilderness
mm-hmm.
Edge property.
Yeah.
Wow. Right. So if that's the feeling, then I suggest we pass a resolution at next council meeting and then start planning what signage we want to put up and then incorporating that into our new enforcement person's job to go around and make sure people are not barbecuing like my God. will it ever end? I don't think so, but is everybody okay with that?
I don't know yet. I don't know where I sit here. Like, I don't think some charcoal barbecues are...
I mean, you can bring a resolution, then we can discuss it. I have to think about it, too.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know.
So to your comment, Sue, I would say let's keep in mind what extra burden that's going to put on Public Works to clean up after it all the time, right? You know, there's that part of it, too, so I'm not... Just something to think about as we're thinking about it.
Well, and the reality that we've gone this many years and people have picnicked without needing, you know, to do that, so.
Well, we have a lot of visitors at the beach now. So.
Well, there's food trucks and the clubs.
I was gonna say, we have a lot of restaurants that want them to buy from them.
I just don't know a public beach campground area that doesn't allow barbecues, though.
Yeah.
Honestly, like, you drive around anywhere, Purtill, everywhere.
Because they have park staff to manage it.
Well.
That is what it, that's why.
Even they have limited staff, though, now with the government. I'm just throwing it out there, like, I get what you're saying. Whitemouth Falls, for example, has zero staff there ever. And there's barbecues everywhere. I'm not saying we do it, I'm just saying it's more to me like a reality, like it's going to happen anyway.
But I think it's safer, if it's going to happen anyway, it's safer to provide them with the proper equipment or a place to dispose of the hot coals.
I need to think about it.
Yeah, I need to think about it. And
okay. For council meeting discussion. Alexander Dock repair / replacement.
Okay, so John has provided two quotes for creating very similar dock setups as to Aberdeen and Prescott. It would be by the same company. Their preference would be the floating dock system. So that would be the $14,120.26. And Crystal has gone through the budget, and she's thinking the $15,000 for the replacement of the Alexander dock. She doesn't have any concerns with this expenditure. It appears that we have larger than expected revenues, and so far the expenses are well under. She was quite surprised when she was examining them today that we're waiting for a big bill. We don't know where.
Right,
it
so
just
we talked about that at Public Works, right? And John was hoping to pull off a lot of work, but now we're down staff again as well. So, and with CNL coming on board, there's a good chance that we're going to share in those costs. I mean, we already philosophically agreed on a safety perspective that we would go ahead with this expenditure, and if it put us over budget, we would live with that. I mean, we already...
The dock is a dock that's been burned down for years.
We already agreed in principle that we were going ahead 100%. With this.
Yep.
I say we go with John's recommendation of the floating dock and get the better one.
So I was wondering, when we do our special meeting, can we add this, if by consensus we agree to add this resolution tonight? To the special meeting?
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I just think because of the time
rightliness
of them trying to get it done.
Okay. Co-op propane price for 20, this just came yesterday for Lewis, and they want an answer by September 1st. So I put together a summary for Lewis to show the savings of choosing the floating price, and if you, for the LGD, it's a bigger volume, so the savings would be even greater. So, this isn't for a decision tonight. We're having a special meeting anyway, right?
Yes.
Before the end of the month, so we can decide that. But I just put together some information for council to consider.
So overall, floating has been cheaper.
Yeah, by $21,000 over 7 years.
So didn't we decide the last year was the 1 year we went fixed, didn't
yes.
we?
Yeah,
we've been floating forever and then we went fixed and we
But Lewis went floating.
Right.
They made their own decision,
floating.
So that's all why I have the numbers right.
Yeah.
But the other thing is I thought the school district raised a good point because they're actually paying the a very significant share, like more than 50%, that we should actually have the discussion with them as well. So
100%, yeah.
We need to move on this quickly. And if we're gonna actually respond by September 1st, I don't know if it's worth giving them a call and saying, look, we're
so
we need an extension.
We had to do that last year and they granted us an extension after a council meeting.
Well, then we probably should ask because
okay.
We might not be
ask.
Able to get all the ducks lined up appropriately unless we all agree right off the hop.
I seem to recall that we asked for the extension and we waited to our council meeting.
Well, let's keep that in mind. If we can get the school district on board with what we for a discussion, then let's expedite that too. Is my summary clear there? And I also actually watched the temperature information to compare. So, I did actually want to point out there's a sudden drop in volume there, and that actually coincides with the new HVAC control system we put in at Lewis. It cut way down on the amount of propane we were using. So the last 2 years are way lower than the previous 4 years, and that's the new control system. It's way more comfortable temperature in the building, so it's actually paying for itself.
And what was the lower years in 2015 and 16? Was that just probably weather dependent?
Yeah, I'm
not sure.
Not sure if my temperature data goes back that far.
All right.
So this is just the Lewis cost?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But when we sign a contract, we're signing it for
Lewis
Community
School,
Center. Community Center.
Not Lewis.
No, Lewis is separate.
Lewis is separate.
They do their own.
So this is Lewis, though. So
he's just showing us.
I'm just
what
showing
they
the data because I have it right.
Is this for the Lewis board to decide?
Yes.
Like why is it here?
Well, Lewis has already decided. I'm just showing you the impact of choosing floating over a fixed rate.
And the same.
It's an example.
We have the same savings for the communities. He just has that exact number.
I see. Sorry.
It's just
right.
an example to
yeah.
reference floating versus fixed.
So I'm pretty sure that that our accountant hasn't had time to do this kind of math, so I'm just sharing it so that you get an idea of what the impact of the decision is.
Yeah, we should share that with the school. They can look at.
Yeah, I'm happy.
Awesome.
Okay. Motion to move in camera for legal. Jason, second by Rhonda, at 8:27.
Or should we be adjourning and doing a special meeting? That's at 8:30. Or does that?
We don't have a special meeting.